campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.
Catherine Gulkey of Elkhorn is a Democratic candidate in 32nd Assembly District. The election is November 3. Catherine, welcome to Wisconsin Eye.
Thank you so much for having me.
I was just curious, what do you consider the top issue in your campaign?
I think my concern is a concern of many residents, and that is that we need to improve our infrastructure for public health. We have definitely seen we were not prepared for the COVID-19 pandemic, and we need to do something about that. One thing I keep hearing from residents is that there's no local testing in District 32, and I think the state should really be looking at that and addressing that and improving our infrastructure so that people can have access to affordable, free testing all throughout the district and don't have to drive 2 hours or take out 4 hours of their day to go to Milwaukee or Racine and wait in long lines. That needs to change.
Well, another part of this is the emotional debate over face masks. The governor up by September 28 must decide whether to extend or let lapse the statewide mask edict. What's your position on that, Catherine?
Well, sadly, this last week, my family actually, despite our efforts to not get COVID, my children got COVID this last week. So we are currently in quarantine. Yeah. The CDC recommends that we should be wearing face masks. The CDC recommends we should be social distancing. We should be washing our hands. These are all public health measures that we can do. I was just reflecting with someone the other day about when seatbelts first came in to play. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I remember being a little girl in the back of my parents' pickup or in the back of our station wagon and just rolling around. And then the seatbelts happened. And I remembered my mom's friend being like, oh, this is the worst thing ever. And I feel so confined and I can't move. But now my children don't think anything about wearing a seatbelt. They have grown up in a culture that wears seatbelts. And so wearing the face mask is really just about a cultural change that we have to do. And we can do that to protect ourselves. We can do that to protect others. And really that's what we're doing is we're caring for our neighbor when we're wearing our face mask, because our face masks keep our germs from getting on someone else. And since the CDC tells us that up to 48, 72 hours before we even show symptoms, we're contagious, that's why we wear the face mask, is so that I might feel fine, but I could still infect you with something that would hurt you a lot. And that's what it's about. It's about protecting ourselves and our neighbors at the same time.
There's a state budget perspective to the COVID-19 debate. It could threaten our state tax collections. I'm making up a number here. If we don't collect $1 billion in state tax collections and you're in the legislature, what would be your approach to answering that? Would you raise taxes or fees, or would you cut spending?
Well, I think first we need to recognize that's a huge, big if, because the Fiscal Bureau showed that there wasn't even a 1% change so far. So it's a huge if. I think the biggest thing that we could do, whether or not we have a budget shortfall, is just expand Medicaid. We know that we are just throwing federal dollars out the door by not giving more access to people. It's not only the morally right thing to do, it is the fiscally responsible thing to do and would really help our budget. We know it's been $1 billion thrown away because we won't expand Medicaid and help people. That's just ridiculous. And then the other thing I think we really need to stop, regardless of COVID, is these frivolous lawsuits. We've been just throwing taxpayer dollars away with private attorneys instead of keeping it in-house with our elected a position with Josh Call, and that needs to change.
So you support Senator Kapinga's bills that says that businesses and organizations that provide the COVID-19 protocols couldn't be sued. You support that, just to clarify.
I support that we need to help our businesses and we need to make sure that they are taken care of. And yes, I need to read the bill in depth, but I support the concept that yes, okay, if your business is doing everything they should, it's hard to say exactly where you get a communicable disease from, right? Like people keep saying to me, how did your children get it? I have no idea how my children got it. We wash our hands. you know, like they shouldn't have got it, but they somehow did. So being able to place blame is really, really hard when it comes to something like this.
The hospitals nationally, and of course in Wisconsin, have played a key role in treating COVID-19. If you're in the legislature voting on the next budget, do hospitals deserve an even greater priority than they may have in the current budget?
Well, I think first we need to recognize that there's a huge safety net. It is not just hospitals who have been addressing the COVID-19 pandemic. Long-term care has really taken a hit with this, with all the measures that they have had to take with their population being such a target of the disease. So once again, this goes back to expanding Medicaid. If we expand Medicaid, we're going to bring in those additional revenues into the town, or sorry, I'm a town supervisor. We're going to bring those additional revenues into the state. And when we bring those additional revenues into the state, we are able to improve the Medicaid reimbursement. We know right now that Medicaid significantly underpays our hospitals, significantly underpays our long-term cares. And then those costs are passed on to us through higher insurance premiums. So we could really do a lot to help the safety net that is helping us with the COVID pandemic by just expanding Medicaid and then increasing the reimbursement.
Well, since you're a county supervisor, let's go to property taxes, which are high in Wisconsin.
Yes.
But
town supervisor, not county, town.
Town. I'm sorry. Thanks for the correction. You're a town supervisor. But towns and local governments have been living under caps.
Yes.
And limits on property taxes for more than 20 years to protect homeowners. Should those caps and limits be continued, town supervisor?
Yes. Well, I support keeping property taxes low for Wisconsin families and small business. Levy limits are one way that that has been done, but it has also made it very challenging for local governments to do their job. I am the chair of the finance committee for my township, and we struggle with the state passing the buck down to us and then not giving us any money to help pay for it. Like their neglect of our roads. Now our local government has to handle that. So I believe we have to invest in our local governments. We have to keep property taxes low for the homeowners. One way we can do that is by closing the dark store loophole. And my opponent has voted against closing the dark store loophole, even though we the voters have said we want it closed. He has done nothing to do that. And the city of Delavan has been sued under the dark store loopholes. And what happens is then instead of that corporation paying their fair share of the taxes, now that's pushed onto the homeowners and the homeowners have to make up the difference. So one way we can really help our local governments and one way we can really help our property tax bills stay low is to close the dark store loophole. It's a no-brainer. One thing I did as town supervisor is I really pushed for a partnership with our local tourism entity to create a convention center on some of our property. And we just got that passed. We just accepted the bid, super excited about it. But our projections show that this innovative partnership is going to make $200,000 to $300,000 for the township a year. And that is going to significantly reduce our property taxes or keep us from having to increase them. And that is just something that we have to do is think outside the box, think about how we can work together to generate revenue that isn't taxes.
Well, do local governments like you serve on, do they need to consider other options of revenue? Is it time to take some handcuffs off and let them consider other sources of revenue?
So as an elected official, if my residents don't think I'm doing what they want, they would vote me out, right? And so I hear from the residents all the time about things they need. For example, all communities, at least where I live, are struggling to fund EMS. We have tons of referendums going on. My township's about to do a referendum for EMS. And so how do we fund that? And how do we address the needs of our growing town under the levy limit structure? So yeah, we need to give local controls back and let the local government talk about that. Local government can be very innovative. Local government can be the grassroots of change. And if one government does it really well, then we can share that with the rest. And the state is just like strongholding us and keeping us from being able to be innovative with how we fund the necessary needs. And when you keep it at a local government level, you can ask those local constituents, hey, does this work for you? What do you think about that? And we can all work together to address the problem of financing our budget.
You said your town is struggling to maintain its local roads. Last year, Governor Evers recommended a gas tax increase. A gas tax is 30.9 cents, mm-hmm. hasn't been raised in more than a decade. Yep. Could you vote to raise the gas tax?
Well, that is a very, very complicated question. While the budget allowed for some investment at the state level in transportation, it did not provide any long-term solutions. And one thing I've heard a lot from residents is, we live in a tourist community, and the way the Joint Finance Committee is funding transportation is just punishing the residents for using the roads, and it's not sharing the cost with the tourists. So, you know, the gas tax is something for there, but I'm very concerned with that. We are clearly having an economic downturn, and people are struggling post-COVID, and how are they going to be able to afford that and get to their jobs? So there's a lot of conversations that need to be had about how to fund the roads. And we need to be having those. We need to make sure that everybody who is contributing to the roads being degraded is helping pay to fix them. And we need long-term solutions. We can't be kicking the bucket down. Like, my town had to take out a loan to fix our roads because the state just keeps kicking it to us. And with the levy limits, we can't save properly to do that. It's just very frustrating.
As the states around Wisconsin legalize medical and recreational marijuana, what's your position?
I support the legalization of marijuana. One, it's been done in a whole bunch of other states. So why are we putting people in jail and destroying their lives when if they lived in just a different community, that wouldn't happen to them? That's just wrong. Also, we spend a tremendous amount of money incarcerating people for a nonviolent crime. And it is disproportionately hitting different populations, and we need to rectify that. It's a waste of our money. It could be a revenue generator for our government. I just don't see a negative to it. And we've seen it done in other states, and we can follow their models.
The debate over policing reforms, there's a lot of different bills floating around in the Capitol, and the speakers going to form a task force.
Yep.
Are there any specific policing reforms you should be enacted and you would vote for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so when this all came down, first with the murder of Blake and Floyd, those murders, I talked to our chief of police at my township about what we're doing at our town level. And I really enjoyed that conversation with him. And I think it's very important that leaders are having those conversations with their chief of police. I love our chief of police. He is such a man of integrity and had so much to share with me. And one of the things our town is looking at is an accreditation process. And in this accreditation process is every day that our officers are on at their job, when they check into work, they will get on their phone or their device, 5 questions. And those 5 questions will be about our policies and our procedure, and just kind of reiterating the culture that we want our officers in our town to exhibit. And I think that is a really great solution. It's how we can easily change a culture. And it also is telling the public, we support and we want a transparent police force that is trained and is exhibiting what we want. I also support the establishing of statewide use of force standards. I support prohibiting discipline of law enforcement officers for reporting violations. I support developing a model use of force policy. I support requiring 8 hours of annual training, which I just said could easily be done with that app. I support banning chokeholds, and I support requiring the Department of Justice to publish an annual report on use of force. I am very concerned with the Vanguard package, in particular how he is talking about taking away local control. As I mentioned, local government is one of the most innovative places there is, and when he has in his plan that if a local government were to adjust what they fund their police departments so that they can make their budget balanced, we should not be punished, the local government, for adjusting our budgets to meet our needs. What if there's been a change in our community? What if we're doing something new and innovative? This state mandating on local governments and taking away our control has got to stop.
As a Democrat, do you support the governor's call for a People's Maps Commission to draw the next set of congressional and legislative boundaries? You do. Okay.
Yes, 100%. Okay. And I am incredibly disappointed in my opponent voting against fair maps. The voters should be picking their elected officials. The elected officials should not pick their voters.
Well, another question, since you serve on local government. When a school board or local government plans a major public works project, should they have to give a preference to Wisconsin businesses?
I definitely support jobs for Wisconsin families, and we need to make sure that we are protecting the local taxpayers. But if we can do more to encourage our local governments to hire local and to have Wisconsin jobs, then we need to do that. So we definitely need to explore what we can do to incentivize local governments to pick Wisconsin companies.
Finally, you've highlighted one difference with your opponent. Do you want to highlight others with the incumbent you're challenging?
Sure, there's so many. But I'll start with, I'm a career advocate, and my opponent is a career politician. So I founded the Wisconsin Association of Free and Charitable Clinics. Before that, I was with my mother's of preschoolers. I serve on the board of the United Way. I serve on the board of the Delavan Lake Improvement Association. I am very involved in my community. My opponent has not had that advocacy type thing. He's been a politician his whole entire life. He gets to vote himself raises, and he gets to vote himself really great health insurance. I know what it's like to pay a high deductible plan. I know what it's like to not get a raise. I know what it's like to work multiple jobs. This is an important thing for an elected official to know and understand. I can relate to the people in my community. I'm raising my family here. Additional things is, he doesn't listen to us, and I will listen to the people, right? We voted to restore the treasurer's duty. He has done nothing to restore the treasurer and the oversight of the treasurer. We voted to end the dark store loophole. He has done nothing to end the dark store loophole. We, the irrelevant, when they reviewed the bills, they found that of the 407 contacts with Rep. Tyler August, 339 were opposed to the proposed bill. And then Tyler voted, but that's 83% of the time. People said, don't vote for this. And yet he voted yes every single time. He doesn't listen to us. So things that I really think need to be focused on is, one, quality neighborhood public schools, affordable health care, and lowering out-of-pocket costs. We have to make sure that people who've had COVID aren't going to be punished in the future, right? Like, I need to know that my children and your children that get COVID, that they'll still be able to get life insurance and health insurance, and that they're not going to be punished at a later date for having experienced something now. We need to do long-term transportation funding. We need to focus on clean water, not just drinking water, but the water actually in our rivers and streams. And we need to improve that public health infrastructure. Pandemics are going to happen. Right, we've had our Dustin Hoffman movie from the 90s. We had our we had that other movie with it's not pandemic outbreak, right? We've had all these movies. We know this has been coming. I've been teaching this for 15 years, public health. We need to improve our infrastructure, and my opponent had 10 years to get our state ready for a pandemic, and he did nothing to prepare us for that. I will help prepare us for that. So this election is about priorities and which direction we want our state to go. And I'm here to listen to the people.
Thank you. Catherine Gulke of Elkhorn is the Democratic candidate in the 32nd Assembly District. The election is November 3. Catherine, thank you for talking to Wisconsin Eye.
Thank you so much for having me. Have a great day.
Thank you. You too.
Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.